all right, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, get ready. We're here at the Roy and Jimmy thing. Get ready to rock, get ready to roll. The moment you've all been waiting for. We got hot, sexy Roy and Jimmy. Hell yeah, yo.
Hey, Monday Night ChaoticRadio.com. You are listening to the Roy and Jimmy thing. My name is Roy Brewster. This is...
I am Dancing Jimmy Shaw. I was back here jamming to that tune right there.
You were bipping a little bit.
I was bipping a little bit. I was, you know, I have to take time to appreciate the theme music, you know? We take it for granted so many weeks.
And it's not something to be taken for granted.
Exactly. I caught myself taking this relationship with this theme song. One of the best theme songs ever, I must say.
Ever.
And I'm taking it for granted it'll always be there. So I had to relax, mute the mic, and just soak it in. How was your week, Mr. Roy Brewster?
My week was good.
Yes. So it's Monday night. We're back. It's us again. Live.
We just told you. Last week we told you we'd be here. And guess what?
We told you we're going to be here. And yeah. We are here.
We sure, you clean that up. You sure as shit are.
You see me stop myself there. I know we can cuss and say shit and all that, but you know, control yourself. Relax.
Control yourself.
Relax a little, will you?
Nice.
You don't have to be a brute about it.
What'd you do this weekend, man? Just this weekend. Not the whole damn thing.
The week was just the usual. Did some work, a little dentistry, got my car fixed, which came out awesome.
I was going to say, how'd that turn out? Done.
New car.
Nice.
New car. It was power steering pump, the rack, rotors, purring like a kitten.
Nice.
Brand new fly ride.
You're all looking like sharp, driving, feeling comfortable doing your shit.
Yep. And I got to run my department Saturday at work.
Ooh.
Got to show them what Jimmy management's all about.
Ooh.
Which was nice there, relaxed a little bit, and prepping for this show with our guest, and then prepping for Thursday show. The ever-changing Thursday show.
Yeah. That's going to be the 23rd, this Thursday.
But we got to give a shout-out for last week's guest. We had Michael Carrillo.
Yeah, Michael Carrillo.
And Stephanie, and I just can't do her last name.
Brittany Olson.
Yes, you've got this nailed.
Yeah, and I got it now.
That was
the J's a Y.
That was a great show last week about Alzheimer's awareness, care, and all that. A lot of stuff we didn't know, and it was great. Great show. So the benefit for that will be this Thursday, 8 o'clock at, what is it called?
Atria Del Rey. 8825 Baseline Road in Rancho Cucamonga. So if you just want to know, it's just east of Vineyard and Baseline. When you get to Legends, right past that, right before the park. It's right in the middle there. Just cozied
right
up in there.
Right next to Legends, across the street from Stater Brothers. Yep.
Got Jimmy, Gus Arredondo, Sean Williams, and us minus one.
Yes.
Derek Murray, too.
Yeah, Derek, he as soon as we posted it, he hit us up, and he wanted to contribute to it, so that's awesome. So Derek, our buddy, has been to the Legacy shows with us. He's got the Jack of All Nerds here on Chaotic Radio on Sunday nights. With Michael Maxwell, that's 8 to 10, and he'll be out there doing it. So I'll be hosting that with, like you said, with Gus Arredondo, Derek Murray, our headliner, Sean Williams, and all for a great cause. So definitely come out, and let's have some fun and raise some more awareness.
And just so you know, tickets are available at the door, or you can contact them directly at 909-346-2471 or pick them up there also. Michael, that's Michael's direct line, man, so use it up.
So the price of a ticket includes, they have food, there's going to be a bar there so you can buy some drinks, and then the show.
So here's the deal. You're going to get appetizers and two drinks for each ticket you get. Now, on the tickets, and we made it clear last week, just so you know, the tickets are a donation. There's no set cost on it, but, you know, step up. We're doing it for a good cause. So get it done. Where are you going to be able to go? You know, let's say you pay $20-$30. You're going to get two drinks, $20-$30 a ticket. You're going to get two drinks and some appetizers. And we're talking world-class chefs. So
yeah, this is not cafeteria food.
No. And you're going to put it on for good people. I really enjoyed the show last week, so much so that I think Stephanie may stop in once in a while. Miss Bjorn Olfson might stop in once in a while. Maybe we're talking about maybe every few weeks to talk about what might be going on. And we're excited to have her in here because that was a change of pace for us, but it was, man, I was in. And I know you were too, Jimmy. That was awesome.
So. No, very informative. Really great show. So we'll definitely, we did our Sunday replay, but we'll definitely put that one up again and let everyone know.
So get that going. See this week. Oh, Thursday. Last Thursday, not this Thursday, but last Thursday, I showed up in Victorville up there at the Redeemer Church. We're
rehearsals. That's right.
It was a little piece of heaven. Going to catch me in that. I was playing my spot. It got to be a little emotional. That's all I'm going to tell you. I'm gonna tear your heartstrings.
Oh, are you?
Oh, we didn't think that might was going to happen. Guess what?
Oh no, the sensitive Roy.
Oh, he was coming out. He was coming out. So just to let you know, hey, that's going to be a lot of fun too. But that's way down. That's in May. So, you know, we'll be pumping that up, or I will, or no one might want to hear it, but I'm going to talk about it anyway. But the big one is this Thursday night. Don't forget this Thursday night. Huge show. Alzheimer's Inland Empire. See, I did it right.
Yes, you did.
And there at the Atria Del Rey, see Michael and Stephanie and say hi. I had to not be there because I'm a dumbass. Maybe I had a little bit of this, as we talked about last week, maybe I had a little bit of that brain memory thing going on I got to worry about, because you know we sat down a month ago and planned this all out for the date. We want to make sure it was all clear, and
right.
I forgot I have a work event that I'm the main speaker at.
It's not just a work thing, it's your work thing.
Yeah, it's my work thing that I, you know, I could sometimes have someone fill in for me, but I'm the main guy. That's going to be hard to get around, so
yeah,
I apologize. I'm feeling real bad about it. You know, I even told Jimmy, you know, some of those shows, you're like, I got to go do one. I was so pumped for this one for some reason. It just sounded like a lot of fun. And probably because it was a good cause type thing.
Sure.
And that we were going to be able to do some good, because it feels good to, you know, Jimmy and I both like to give back when we can. I mean, we've done a couple shows to raise some money for some people, and that always makes you feel good. So, sorry about that, but we're still promoting like crazy. Jim's taking over the big duties. And then we've got Gus and Derek, and one more time, the killer beast, Sean.
The beast that he is, yes. Yeah. So, no, a great lineup. You're going to be sorely missed. But
well, definitely. Probably not so much, because there's some talent there. I'll be all right.
You guys, you'll be okay.
It'll be just fine. I'll be like, who was got? Oh, yeah, I forgot all about it.
I forgot that part, yeah.
And so, you know, it's like a PG-13 deal. So, you know, you can bring in, there's no real age limit or anything. Michael hit me up, wanted to know they were asking. I said, yeah, we geared everyone up for PG-13.
Yeah.
So if you could see it on TV, I mean, you know, after 9 o'clock, that's still PG-13. You know what I'm saying? It gets on airwaves.
It is a comedy show.
So they're just, you know, God dang it. Dang it. But anyway, we move on. I told Stephanie, and all I got back from her was no. And I went, oh, well, yeah, it was nice knowing you. She probably not going to talk to me ever again. But yeah. No, she took it very well, and she understood.
So here's everything, Stephanie. I got to go.
Yeah, I got to go.
I can't make it.
Well, if we had like had to cancel the whole thing, that might have been ugly.
Oh, that would have been.
And it was kind of like a godsend that Derek wanted to be on, because we're like, yeah, we'll get you to squeeze you in there. Well, now he's not squeezing in there anymore. It's just, you know, full-blown let's go.
Give a little more time for those guys. And, yeah, so definitely a fun evening. And pick up tickets there. Like I said, the price is donation, so whatever you can do or feel like doing, much appreciated. It's definitely raising funds for all the work they do for Alzheimer's awareness and care.
Big topic. But
go on iTunes and look that our last week's episode up if you want more information on how the care is administered, distributed, and future plans for it, and definitely ways to cope with a family member having it, and also some preventative measures, which I think is one of the most important things. That early detection.
Well, that's why I thought it was so neat. It wasn't just talking about the people going through it, like as a, you know, like the person who has Alzheimer's. They really got into how important their support system is, and the family and the loved ones,
oh, yeah.
And how they can help, and how they have to see from a different perspective to understand how they can help. So, right. I mean, I don't want to say enough about it. you know, we're like, we got to move on. But I can't tell you enough about how much that show meant to me, especially having someone that was, you know, affected my grandmother by dementia and all that. And the feedback we got was great. And I had a lot of people hit me up. And I like that they were able to have some fun with it. So it made a serious thing, easy to listen to. So you guys are, sure. You guys rock.
No, so definitely one of our most, the more you know episodes.
Right. We got to get moving. Come on.
Yeah, we have, tonight we have on the show, actor, comedian, writer, producer, Jimmy Della Valle.
Yes, I mean, Sopranos, Conan, Comedy Central, Without a Trace, My Name is Earl, Unfabulous, Oz, Sex and the City.
And he's one of those guys, too. As soon as you see his face, you go, yep, I seen this guy, I know this guy. Hilarious stand-up also. So he's calling in, he's going to call in, we're going to take our break at a little early tonight so we can clear the decks and get him in here. And but definitely call for that one. We're looking forward to having Jimmy in.
America's Got Talent? I mean, come on, man.
Yeah.
It doesn't stop. Matter of fact, I hope he's not listening now. It'd be cool if he was, but if he's not, it's kind of cool because he's going to go, what did I get myself into? Thanks, Coop. Steve, you're listening. Thanks. Steve got us the hookup on that.
Mr. Cooper talked.
Got Jimmy all set up on that. Our Jimmy. That's how we're going to have to do this thing. We're going to go, which Jimmy are we talking to? So it might be a little interesting. Maybe not. Probably not a big deal.
Maybe not, no.
No, he's a pro. Whatever. Be like, yeah, he's been on Sirius. I mean, now he's here.
There you go.
So I did that on last Thursday. Man, that was we stretched right around the corner on that one. But that's going to be fun. We should blast into the stuff.
Absolutely.
Our stuff quick. Today is... Oh, dude, I was on it. 286 days till the first of the year, January 2018. 6,867 hours, 412,061 minutes, which means 24,723,680 seconds at the beep beep until Monday, January 1st, 2018, Los Angeles time.
Los Angeles time, very important. Yes.
Yeah, we'll mix it up like that. So. Daylight savings times. You know, we're into that now. We started that Saturday. Love it. Get home from work. It's a light.
I love all that part, but man, I'll tell you, it is jacked right. Me so bad.
So we've got 286 days, 3 hours, 40 minutes, and 55 seconds till the new year. Boom.
Look at you. Damn. Even with my interruption.
I was planning on
that. That is some pro shit right there.
Till the new year. So we're looking forward to that. Hey, today... We're gonna do it again? Oh my god!
No, we need a tape. We got a flaw.
Or any of your IM force be caught or killed, the secretary will disavow any knowledge of your actions.
Wouldn't that be good if life was like that?
It would be awesome.
Just disavow any of your actions.
Any of your actions. A couple big. Today's the first day of spring.
Is it today?
Today is the first day of spring.
Boy, oh boy!
And we're gonna kick it off with vigor, with some rain tomorrow.
And what do? We here in Southern California, we immediately dropped 15 to 20 degrees from yesterday.
Oh, yeah. You know why?
First day of spring took us right back into chill mode.
Because Mother Nature knows.
It knows. Still needs that chill for those, March goes out like a lion.
Right.
And which it did.
Yeah, they got April showers for Mayflowers.
Bringing the Mayflowers. So we're going to have a little rain, I think, in the next couple of days. Just a little bit. There's your April showers. Well, it's still March, but, you know, we're building
it. We're
getting
there. I saw a lot of people post. They're doing a lot of blooms thing where you go out and check out all the blooms everywhere.
Yeah.
Man, freaking beautiful with all the rain.
Oh, absolutely.
I saw Sandra post a bunch of stuff.
You got that. It's probably all weeds, but when you see all the mountains and the ranges with that cover of green, yeah, it's just gorgeous.
And beautiful. There's another one going up in Julian I'd like to get to, but it's next Friday, and, you know, I got to work.
Those all the poppies up there? Is that Julian?
Poppies, and, I mean, just all kinds of wildflowers everywhere, so that's kind of cool. Today is also anniversary of, let's all bow our heads.
It's bowed.
You need to bow yours farther.
Oh. Uh-huh.
Today was the anniversary of?
What?
Big Bird's demise.
Yes, our car wreck. I saw it in my time hop, so I didn't put it up, and then I saw you put it up there. But yeah.
Can you believe that was 6 years ago?
Damn. That went quick.
And it was raining that night.
It was coming down. That's why we crashed.
That's why we crashed.
Yeah.
So, Big Bird, rest in peace. Thank you for all our lives, because... You know, we're all here kicking. You guys wouldn't have Monday night. No, Big Bird didn't do his job.
That was a good. That was a good truck. We bent it in half. It bent in the middle.
Yeah, it was. It was pretty bad.
It pretty bent. We bent that shit.
Yeah. Jimmy's favorite quote on the picture I posted was, "You okay? Boom. You all right? Boom. You all right? Boom."
That still makes me laugh because I don't remember saying that between all the hits. But you and Ariana both said every time I hit, boom, you okay? Bam, you all right? Boom, you okay?
I only think I got a couple of them out because I think that one of them I was going through that side window, you know. Wear your seatbelts, people, is all I'm telling you.
And Ariana reminded us your free ear piercing.
Yes, yes, I did.
When you said what, they popped the cartilage back in, so here you go, boop.
Yeah. It was foul. They're looking at it going, I don't know how I'm going to fix this. Because on the top big part of my ear, you know, the flat part in the middle, it just, the hole got poked all the way through it. And I remember going, I don't know. I don't know. And they put stitches in the bottom of my ear to put the lobe back on.
Yeah.
And then they go, I don't know how I'm going to. And he messed around and he pushed it into it. And it went. He goes, oh, there. That'll fix it. Wipe it off with a little bit of alcohol. It's good to go.
Little spit in a fucking tissue. You're all set. A little mommy remedy right there.
Wow. That was crazy. So, Big Bird, rest in peace, man. We love you. We miss you. And thank you.
Yeah, we were on our way to the Ice House. We had a show.
You know, I still think when the tow truck driver came to get Jimmy and they said, where were you going? And said the Ice House. And they're putting it on the truck and said, Jimmy had the thought of him taking it to the Ice House and pulling
it
up.
He said, do you need a ride?
Right.
Yeah. I said, yeah, I got a show at the Ice House. And he says, you need a ride? I would have just loved the flatbed in the truck. Just pull right up, do my set, and then leave.
If you had it to do over again, would you might have done that?
Knowing the outcome of everything.
Right.
Because they took you away, so I wasn't sure what was wrong with you.
Right.
But if I knew the outcome, then yeah, for sure. Hey, Roy, I'm going to go do our sets.
I'd be like, right on. Yeah, pick me up on the way back, right? And then I had Bubba Gump taking care of me outside in the rain. That was cool.
In the pouring rain, where are you?
Yeah. And Jimmy found out I didn't wear a seatbelt because they found out who I was. Jimmy didn't even know I was. I flipped around in the back.
You landed right where I saw you last. So I remember after we landed, I buried that thing in the walk. I got tired of hitting that concrete full speed. So I buried it, NASCAR'd it right into the pit wall. And just slowly had that thought going, all right, I got to see if these two are around. And you guys were just sitting there, and you just grabbed your ear, and you're going, your window's broke. We didn't know your head went through it.
Yeah, my favorite part of that was it was raining, and I'm grabbing the side of my head, and I'm like, God, man, rain. And then I'm like, wait, I'm all wet from the rain. I went, oh, wait a minute, I'm inside.
That's not rain.
This rain is red.
You know what? I wish technology was caught up because right now I would have been on a dash cam video from somebody.
Oh, yeah.
That would have been awesome because we didn't hit nobody and no one hit us. That was a miracle.
Can you imagine we were Facebook live when it went down?
Oh, man. Just whoa-bam. That
would have been awesome. Everyone would have been like, ah! My mom probably would have been watching, you know, and all of a sudden the camera's flying around. No!
The viewers would have been more traumatized than we were because we were pretty calm going through all that.
Yeah, live it might not have been good, but the replay would have got a lot of hits, Jimmy. That's what I'm saying. A lot of hits.
The post on that would have been awesome, yeah.
Oh, my God. Alien Abduction Day today. International Day of Happiness is today. And Kiss Your Fiancé Day. Oh, shit, I missed that one.
Whoops.
It's American Chocolate Week this week, National Button Week, whatever the hell that means, and National Fix a Leak Week. I don't know about that, but I've got to take a leak a lot lately.
There you go.
National Nutrition Month and National On Hold Month and National Peanut Month. And we're not talking about Peanut Slam Jam either.
Fucking guy.
I got a pair of socks. I got a pair of socks. First winner going to get a pair of socks.
A pair of socks, a drink, and then...
Oh, then all the shit came
motherfucking
out.
Jimmy Shaw.
Motherfucking Jimmy Shaw.
All right, we're going to take our first break.
Yeah, that's why I get it in there real quick. We're out of here.
All right, we're going to take our break here. We're going to come back. We're going to have Jimmy Della Valle with us. And so definitely give us a call, 909-360-8330.
We'll see you in a minute, guys.
Tonight.
Welcome back to the Roy and Jimmy thing on chaoticradio.com. Give us a call. You're going to want to. 909-360-8330.
We are back from our quick-ass break right there.
Quick one. We have a big name on the line, so we can't just stay at the break forever like normal.
Exactly.
Exactly.
You like how I agree with that?
Exactly.
All right. Well, we have our guest on the phone. I'm going to give him a proper introduction that I'm going to plagiarize right here. Let's see here. Let's go here.
Ladies and gentlemen, our next act coming to the stage, he's a national touring headliner. He's an actor. You may have seen him on The Sopranos, on Conan, originally from New York. He's here tonight. Please give a warm welcome for my friend, Mr. Jimmy Del Valle. Let him hear it.
There we go. Welcome, Jimmy.
Hey, how you doing, guys?
We're good, man. Thanks for calling in, bud.
Perfect. I just posted it where they can call in. I didn't know that. I thought that was the bat phone. I didn't know that was the calling number.
Oh, man, they got it. Bring them.
Yeah, cool. So are we able to swear or no?
Absolutely.
It's all yours, baby.
Oh, I didn't know. I don't have to swear, but I do.
You don't have to contain the urge.
Excellent.
So how have you been, man? What have you been up to?
Oh, good, man. I actually just found out that I just got a part earlier, actually, in a new horror film that they're shooting in upstate New York. So going to be doing that in the next few months. So just found that out. So that just happened.
Well, you know, I looked up our buddy Steve Cooper hooked us up. And so I've known you as a comic. But you're one of them guys. You see your face and you go, I've seen him. Yep, I've seen him here. I've seen him all over the place. I saw your acting reel and I'm like, all I've been doing since I've seen your acting reel is going, this fucking guy's going to be on here. This is great. This fucking guy's coming on our show.
Yeah. Oh, that's, you know, it's hilarious. I started working the cruise ships in the last few years and, you know, they're always like, they've never seen anyone like me or nothing like that. You know, the audiences, they're like, we've been going on cruises, blah, blah. And the other guy, this one comedian, a great comedian, Joe Malotti, out of St. Louis, and he's Italian, straight 100% Italian, but he's not a Goomba. He's like, so he goes back after working with me for 2 weeks or a week or whatever it was, and his wife is like, oh my God. She's like, could you stop trying to be fucking Jimmy Davis? Ridiculous. We live in St. Louis. There's no mafia. There's dairy farmers. You know, it's just.
I'm Italian and I try to do the same thing. My girlfriend, she goes, you can't pull it off. Stop. Just stop it.
Oh, yeah. And it's so funny because it's exactly who I am. There's nothing fake or phony about it. But when I go into auditions, they'll go, you know, so I'll literally go in, and they're like, they're really looking for the Brooklyn guy. So I'm, so it's nice, and it's good to be here. Yeah, I'm doing this, and I'm doing a scene, and they're like, Jimmy, you don't have to do nothing. Stop faking the accent. And I go, I'm just pushing a little bit. They go, you don't have to do anything. Just be who. Just talk just like talk. This, and then I'll get the part. You know what I mean? But they say it happens all the time. You know, because it's like, I remember I was doing this film with what the fuck is it? Oh, Lance Henriksen. You know Lance Henriksen?
Yeah.
Yeah. You know he's droid is droid does. You know he does a million voiceovers. So I'm doing the voiceover for it, and he's sitting there, and and he's the guy is going, the director. I remember I actually ended up quitting the film, and I had already been paid, but it was just so goofy. The guy was like, he's like, try to be more like John Favreau, like the actor, because I had to match the voice. He right. goes, he's a New York accent. I go, who's the actor playing this guy that you're trying to tell me? I go, John Favreau's from New York. I go, this guy is from fucking Kentucky. And he's doing a fake accent like he saw Goodfellas too many times. This is ridiculous. Rain. And then Lance is like, Jimmy, tell him to go fuck himself. And I'm like, you know what? Go fuck yourself. And I left. And I left. I go, this is, you know, you can't do, if someone's doing a fake accent, it's pretty hard to match that voice. I mean, and I match a lot of voices over the years of different right. things. But, yeah, so anyway, it was a funny thing. And, you know, Lance is just the king, you know. He was in Terminator, everything. Anyways. like a mentor. But that's it. You know, that's it. But I got my new film coming out called The Cross Up. We're about to hit all the film festivals. We did one screening. We did a question and answer, and people went nuts. They loved it. And it looks like we're going to be going through to all the film festivals with it, and hopefully a nomination for Best Actor is
it's in
my future. I mean,
well, I'm sure. Well, are you already practicing your speech?
Yeah. All the people that told me I wasn't going to amount to anything, all the Catholic schools I've been kicked out of, yeah.
Well, I think that would be the chance you could use that, what they told you. Just tell them to go fuck themselves, and that's what you do.
I know. That'd be great.
That'd be awesome.
That'd be awesome.
Well, yeah, I see here on IMDb, tell everyone your character's name in The Cross-Up.
Oh, Sammy Faustino.
Is that not a typecast? No typecast. No.
Yeah. Yeah, but it's hilarious, you know, and it's Eddie Velez is the director, who is, Jesus, he was in White Chicks. If you saw White Chicks, he's the one, who would you fuck? Rosie O'Donnell. Do you remember him?
Yeah.
And then Eddie was in Traffic opposite Benicio Del Toro. He was in, I mean, everything. He was in the A-Team back in the day, where he was the guy who came in and rescued. He played Frankie Santana.
Damn.
So he would come in and rescue, you know, like B.A., you know, Mr. T, and anyways, and Murdoch and Hannibal. So it was pretty. So, and we did a movie years ago called Marriage Vows.
Okay.
And it's funny, actually. I think that just went on my IMDb. I don't know if it's up. It's supposed to be coming out on.
There we go.
It is right now. I'm looking at it. It's up there. You're playing Jimmy.
I actually play a stalker comedian, which is really funny. And so I think it's going to be on Netflix or something. I don't know. Whatever. But they hadn't got distribution. I think they hadn't finished. I don't know what the deal was. But me and Eddie became like brothers.
Nice.
And then all of a sudden I wrote a commercial, and he you know, kind of rewrote it with me, and then we co-directed it, and then we did a pilot that I starred in called Not for Nothing, which is like a blue collar Seinfeld, and then The Cross Up, and then we also did a film called Target Jeremy that we shot about the Middle East, a feature film, and I actually play a Middle Eastern guy who speaks Farsi.
Wow.
So Target Jeremy will be coming out probably in 2018.
Well, looking at your IMDb page, you're playing a lot of dudes named Jimmy, which I like, obviously.
You know, it's funny because my buddy Billy Gardell did the same thing.
Yeah.
I saw him, you know, and I think that's even like his little, like his trivia note or something. It'll say how many times has he played Billy, because he was Billy in like Yes, Dear, and, you know, I think Avenging Angelo, he played Billy. He played Billy in a lot of things.
That's right, yeah. The one on Marriage Vows, though, me being a comedian Jimmy, I can totally use that. I like that.
I like the little synopsis. Ex-wife moves into newlywed's home and brings her new husband and announces they are swingers and want them to be one, too.
Oh, yeah. It's so funny. I remember the girl. So, like I said, I played a comedian, and then I go and I stalk them at their parties and their swinger things, and I'm in the bed with this girl. She's gorgeous. Her name was Kiana something. And she had this, like, fat ass, like, but really soft skin, you know, like a stripper, you know what I mean? Like, with, not that I've ever touched one before, but you know what
You've
I mean?
You've heard. Sure. You've heard.
And she had a skinny waist with this fat ass, and it was like a Kim Kardashian type thing, and she's in the bed in this cute little, like, almost like, you know, bikini, negligee, whatever the hell it is, and I see the director whisper to her, and the director was Larry Flash Jenkins, who was on The White Shadow.
Yes, I know. Oh, yes. I knew that name. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, and he was in was it Fletch?
Fletch, yes, that's right.
Yeah.
Damn.
Yeah, yeah. So it was, so I, and then all of a sudden we do the take, and this bitch slaps me so hard, and I fall over backwards out of the bed. I've got a mark on my face. Makeup's got to cover me up, and I'm like, what the hell? I'm like, what the fuck? What the hell's wrong? want. She's like, he told me that I'm sorry. And she's like kissing on my cheek and stuff. I'm sorry. And he's like, I want it to look real. He's like, we got it. It looks great. I'm like,
And you're reassuring him. Yeah, it was real. We're good.
I mean, she hit me. I mean, Jesus. Like, I owed her money for her, you know, I was her baby's daddy. And it was ridiculous, man.
Well, your IMDb is obviously full. You're a comic. Wait, did one feed the other? Did the acting come first? Stand up?
So this is what happened. If you go in and you Google Jimmy Della Valle, you'll see a black and white picture of me in a leather coat, which my wife always breaks my balls. She's like, all right, everybody was good looking once. I'm like, no. Weren't as good looking as I was as a comedian.
Let's see this.
Oh, I'm looking at it right now.
Yeah.
Hands in the pocket, kind of like got that look on. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, damn. Yeah.
So everybody, they wanted me. I was up for Carter Verone in Fast and the Furious with Fast and Furious 2. And what the hell's his name? Hauser got the part, the famous actor. He has that deep growl.
Oh, but yeah. Rutger Hauer?
No, not Rutger Hauer. Oh my God, Wings Hauser was his dad, but he's the other one. I can't remember. Oh, he's in Pitch Black and stuff. I can't remember what the hell his name. But anyways, that was like, and I didn't know how to act, but everybody was bringing me in for everything. And my manager was like, "Hey, The Sopranos wants to meet with you," and I was like, Sopranos, like, what? I don't sing, I don't know nothing about, like, and they wouldn't give me any script. David Chase wouldn't give me any information, you know. I didn't know David Chase at that point, and so I couldn't do it. I was like, nah, I got a show, I'm not gonna go do it, and I was out of town, so I didn't go to my audition. They shot the pilot and whatever, and then it continued. And then throughout the seasons, they kept bringing me in, and I'd get a call back every time. You know, and I really hadn't taken acting classes. It was just getting in on my look. Like, I do the bit in my act all the time. Like, I'm like, yeah, I moved out to L.A. because I got the look, and I guess I do because, you know, the directors are like, look, you're not right for this, right? You know, so that's what happened. So it became this thing of the look, and then it was like, and then I got this really good manager where he was like, okay, you got the look, now you need to get the chops. So then I went to school, and I went to NYU for 6 months, and, you know, and I've done over 50 commercials and everything.
So it was Cole Hauser from Fast and the Furious.
Yeah, Cole Hauser, yeah. Exactly.
Well, check this out, Jimmy. We actually already have a caller for you, my friend.
Oh, okay.
We got a Frankie Ray on the line.
Frankie Ray!
Yes,
oh my God.
Frankie Ray. Hey, Frankie, you're on the air, buddy.
What's going on? I need me some Jimmy thing.
Frankie Ray, what's up, buddy?
Are you hearing this guy's voice? Holy shit, this is nice.
Oh, ladies and gentlemen, live with the Jimmy Thing Hour. Wow. We're coming to you from KABC, Malibu, California. We're just a little bit off of the coast.
Beautiful.
What are you guys doing down there, man?
Oh, man, we're doing good. Having a ball with Jimmy, man. How you doing, Frankie?
Yeah, we're just sitting back going to enjoy this ride. That's all there is to it.
You know what? I have to tell you, I'm after Jimmy Stack. I want Jimmy Stack. Jimmy's been stacking a stack that's got my name on it.
He's talking about poker.
Yeah. Nice.
Well, Jimmy's got a big stack. It's a sexy stack, and I want it.
Well, I did see that you played, you did play it, you played the in one of the World Poker Tour deals. I actually played in three of them.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I played in Aruba, and then I played Bellagio, and then here at the LA Poker Classic too.
I'm still making the celebrity poker tour, the 5 days, the 3 days, you know, anymore. You know, and that's what happens. I was actually literally supposed to be in Reno tomorrow shooting my new comedy special, and we just renegotiated the contract, and we're going to do it in the next few months.
Well, see, that's your problem why you can't play on the tour anymore. My problem was I always got my ass whooped.
Yeah.
That was the big difference there.
You know, Frankie Ray, the way I met Frankie Ray was I was in the Jack Black Celebrity Tournament for what's her name, Lori Hartwell.
Yeah, Renal Support Network.
Yeah, Renal Support. She's the sweetest lady, and it was a great thing. And I was sitting. I had made the final table, and then I got knocked out. And I was like, okay, whatever. And then my buddy Masi Furlan, a great actor, he was behind Frankie, and he's like, "This is my buddy Frankie. He's a great, you know, actor and all that." And I'm watching Frankie, and Frankie had this crazy outfit on, and Frankie was playing. So I'm sitting behind him, and I'm such a poker player. I'm sitting behind him and just watching Frankie fold and whatever, and we're talking but he didn't really know me until then. Then he went and he like followed me on Facebook, and then we became friends. So anyways, that's cool. I didn't know you were going to call in, Frankie. That's nice.
I didn't either. Actually, you know, it was a little bit more in depth than that. Jimmy's standing behind me, and I got this whole bank of people, and here's this big fucking Goomba. Pardon me, I can't say that.
You can.
Yes, you can.
One cable?
You're good to
go. Yeah, you're good to go, man.
Okay, this big fucking Goomba is behind me, and he's watching over my shoulder. And so I'm revealing my cards to everybody so they can. It's a charity thing. I'll let everybody see. And, you know, I'm an old poker player. And I'm making hard poker moves. They're difficult choices in the situation. And Jimmy leans over and he goes, "My money's on you." So yeah. Like three hands later, I take down first place, and Jimmy saunters off like, hey, who's got the look? Who's got the eye? I told him, Jimmy, hey. He didn't say that. He doesn't sound like that. But just took down third in another celebrity poker tournament last week. Jimmy was in Carson City, so I didn't get a chance to play with him, but I'm coming for you, Jimmy.
I know you are, buddy. We're gonna see the thing. Cool. Well, thanks, Frankie, for calling in, brother. I appreciate it, man. This is good.
All right, man. It was nice talking with you guys. You guys have a great night. This is Frankie Ray live in Malibu, California, signing off on the Jimmy Theme Show.
Perfect. Thanks for calling, Eric.
Hey, thanks for calling, man.
Later, guys.
Wow, look at that, man. Yeah, you want your stack.
You know, it's hilarious, man. They come for it. I mean, you know, it's so much fun. I stopped playing for many, many years, but I've been playing. Jason Alexander had invited me into his WeSpark.org, which is a celebrity thing. And Mark Wahlberg hosted, not Mark Wahlberg from the Burgers, not that one. The Antique Roadshow.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and he's a good, great poker player. He actually made the final table this year. And it was about between 200 and 300 people, but yeah, we play them all, and it's a lot of fun. And you know, they make a lot of money for the charities.
Oh, that's awesome.
And Lena Wynn, who's also and then Sammy Phillips from Penthouse Magazine, who's they run one for Penthouse or Hustler or something like that. I forget. Anyways, all right, so good. We'll have to play poker sometime.
Yeah, no, not now.
Okay.
I thought it was a good idea for a while, but now all of a sudden, not so much. Yeah. See, remember, you quit playing because you didn't have time. I quit playing because I run out of talent about the second hour. See, it's a completely different thing.
Yeah, it happens.
So, where's your stand-up coming from? What got you into that? Also, with the acting.
So I'm in Catholic school, and I'm in the fifth grade, and my best buddy Mike Thompson, right? He would tell me a joke every day, and I'd go up and I'd tell the girls and stuff and whatever, and I can never remember the joke. I can only remember the punchline. So to this day, I come up with a punchline and then I write a joke around it. That's how I do it. So I've been doing it since I was literally in the fifth grade. And the teachers, I got kicked out of Catholic school in the fifth grade. They said I was the devil. My mother wanted to divorce my father. It's because of you. He swears, and you know, so this whole crazy thing. And because she's Irish, and and my dad's Italian, so you know that was the whole mixed. And we had Catholic school. It was brutal. So they had to call public school and see what to do with me. I literally was in the hallway more than the janitor. It was crazy. It was crazy, and so then all of a sudden, then I go right to, I go to the public school first day in the school. I see this cute girl come up to me. She's smiling at me. And she's like, my sister likes you. I'm like, does your sister look anything like you? She goes, exactly. We're twins. Bam. So this girl, so I'm literally that day, okay, we're boyfriend and girlfriend that day. I'm like in the sixth grade. And it was pretty amazing. So.
I like that part. She looked like you. Yeah, yep, done. Handle.
Yeah.
We're boyfriend, girlfriend. Done.
Yeah. Yeah, it's actually fun. I never actually told that story like that before, but it actually kind of sounds funny for a bit.
It does. So you started there. You figured, what got you on stage for the first time?
Well, so I was actually a major break dancer. Major. Well, you know, I wasn't, like you see, I wasn't like, you know, heavy set. You know, I was in really good shape, and I was a major break dancer, like big, big time. To win talent shows, trophies, everything. Actually taught break dancing with at the break dancing school. I can't remember the name of it. But then, right from there, I started riding bikes, like freestyle.
Uh-huh.
And one of my best friends was Dave Mira, who, you know, passed away last year. Dave Mira, the famous BMX freestyler. And I rode for GT, and I traveled all over. You know, we toured. And then he went went to Haro. And out of anything I've ever did, to know James Gandolfini, to Vinnie Jones, to anything, any acting, to these directors or whatever, riding bikes, my all-time favorite thing.
Damn, you
know?
Wow.
Yeah. So a lot of people don't know that about me, you know, because, you know, but there's a comedian in New York who's a great comedian. He was managed by Ray Romano's manager, and we had met at a comedy club, and he's like, I remember you when I was a kid from riding bikes. Oh, my God, I went to see, and his name is George Gallo, who's a great comedian, and he still, to this day, in his 40s, still rides, right?
Damn.
I would break my ankles. I couldn't do it now, you know.
So were you into that era of electric boogaloo, breaking two?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's funny. So I'm in New York, and his name is Sig Miguel. He's a famous casting director. And he casted the movie Empire, not the TV show Empire. The movie Empire, who, I'm trying to think. Oh, well, Leguizamo, John Leguizamo was in it.
Okay.
And I go up and I audition, and he's like, man, he goes, you know, the director really likes you. And the director's name was Frank Reyes, who was one of the leads in Beat Street.
Oh, Jesus.
Right? And he had gotten a three-picture deal. So I went, and then all of a sudden, right before I move to L.A., Frank Reyes is bringing me in for all these movies to, like, do table reads, and I'm going to be, like, attached to this film and this film. And then all of a sudden, I just, like, picked up and moved. I picked up and moved to L.A. I got married and literally moved to L.A. right after my honeymoon, within, like, a week.
Wow.
It was like, boom, 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 done. And my wife was back in New York, in Brooklyn, packing boxes, and I'm out here auditioning already. Boom, boom, you know, sitting in my condo.
Damn.
Yeah.
Let's see if I can get you feeling about.
Yeah, that is breaking. That is definitely breaking.
Yep. Let's see if we get you
now.
Feel a comeback coming. Who was that dude?
If I was on Skype right now, you'd see me popping. I'd be doing the worm, whatever you need.
Well, who was that other dude? God, I'm going to say it wrong. Shabadoo?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Shabadoo. So Turbo, I think Shabadoo is his real name. I only met him once, but actually the guy who opens for me a lot, his name is Little Rob, and he was a big time break dancer, and he's really good friends with them, and they actually do a big break dancing jam on Monday nights in Long Beach, and Turbo and all those guys from Breaking are there and all that.
Damn.
So when's the last time you just broke down and, I mean, you felt it and you had to go back and do a little breakdancing?
A little breakdance, a little pop and lock, would you?
I actually, the other day, on the cruise ship, I got down and did a little break-in because they got a circle. And
started feeling it.
Yeah, and these guys are like the real breakers on the ship, and they got the circle going, and I was like, oh, I don't know if I should, you know, and because the 2 weeks before that, I was like nervous, I didn't do it, and then the next 2 weeks, I was like, screw it, I'm doing the fucking circle, man. I used to own this circle. I got in, and I did like the worm and hit my balls, and I was like, oh my god. And then I tried to do a windmill and cracked my hand, like it didn't, you know, it just, but my body cracked, and I was like, oh my god, I'm gonna break dance, I'm gonna break a hip. I was really like, and my wife was like, what the fuck is wrong? I told her, what the fuck is wrong with you?
A couple years ago at a house party, I threw my brother, he's a couple years younger than me, song came on, he had a few drinks, he felt it, and did the worm on my concrete floor, and when his hip slammed in, his shoe popped off. You know, I cheered you on, but man, that looked painful, man.
Oh, that's funny. That is funny.
It's funny how sometimes you're in there and you're like, your mind is still back there and your body just ain't there anymore, man.
Oh no, I think I still have it on my resume, but I really don't want to go into. You know, it's funny. Was it the actor Nick Nicotera, who's been in a lot of stuff? He was actually, I think he was on Wild and Out, you know, that thing where Nick Cannon, you know, they were.
Oh, MTV, yeah.
So Nick was on there, and he's, me and him used to audition against each other all the time. And he's a great actor, great dude. And we both auditioned for, do you remember when Radio Shack just became The Shack? Like they were trying to be cool?
Yeah, yes. About 4 or 5 years ago, yeah.
So I go up for the audition, I get the call back, and they've got me breakdancing for like 5 minutes. And I literally walk out of that thinking I was going to have a heart attack. And I'm like, I don't want to get this part, you know? I mean, unless they can get this shit in one take and then take me to the hospital. I mean, it was so, and then he got it, and he told me, he's like, dude, this was, he booked it, and he was like, he goes, it fucking sucked filming that fucking commercial.
Kicked his ass.
Like, the dude's like, all right, go back to one, take, let's do a different take, and he's like.
Jimmy's on a 10-minute knee break, so I need a knee here. Take it easy.
Yeah, so, yeah.
Well, I can only assume your first time on stage, you just killed it.
So my first time on stage, I did do very well.
Now, were you nervous because of the different atmosphere, or did you just the attitude you have right now? You just said, "I'm just going to do it. I don't care."
No, I literally couldn't look at the audience. I looked at the ground, and but you know, I was like a handsome kid. Like then, I was like a JCPenney model at that time. Right. So it was like, you know, so I knew my looks were good. I had the, you know, the slicked hair and all that stuff. I looked like Bud Bundy. I used to joke about it on stage. And, you know, I was like, you know, like 170, 180, you know, whatever, and I'm 6 foot tall. So I'm like, you know, I'm on stage, and I'm like, you know, they said that, and I'm looking down, I'll never forget, I'm like, they said that, you know, club owner says if you're nervous, all you have to do is pretend that the audience is in their underwear. And, you know, and they kind of laugh, you know, but they're, you know, they're nervous too because they can tell you're nervous.
Exactly.
Right?
They're feeling
And I go, you know, all you got to do is pretend that they're in their underwear. And I go, the funny thing is, this lady right here is not wearing any. Huge laugh. She comes up to me. She's like, what do they call the lawyer secretary? A legal, paralegal?
Yeah. Paralegal, yeah.
Yeah, she comes up and she goes, you were so funny. And just so you know, she whispers in my ear, I'm really not wearing any. Oh. And I'm like, oh my God. So I hooked up with her, I remember. She's like, you know what I mean? And I'm like 19 and she's like 24, 25, you know, whatever it was.
So you crushed it your first night on stage.
Yeah.
Yeah, not necessarily on stage.
And then, you know, and then that's the thing. So I've been, you know, I'm 45. I've been a comedian since I was 19, and it's all I've really ever done. And it's like, sitting there doing it, and then all of a sudden I'm in New York City doing shows. I'm a pro, and I'm doing minimum 30 shows a week.
Yeah.
And I come up with Patrice O'Neill and Rich Voss, and you know, all these are my guys, you know, and you know, and they're helping me get better, and you know, whatever, they take me under their wings, and I'm sitting there, and I'm going, oh man, this is great. And then all of a sudden, there's like 6 months to a year where everything I say sounds racist. They get, it gets groans, but I'm still doing shows. I'm still getting paid, and then I'm going, what the fuck? Like, I don't understand. Like, I can't figure out what's going on.
Where's the turn, yeah.
You know, I'm doing the same bit. I don't understand. I'm not delivering the joke, you know. And then all of a sudden it went away. And then it came back like 10 years later for like maybe a week or two. And I was like, oh my God, should I quit? What is going on? And then it went away. And then I just started really going, okay. You know, it was almost like I was making a living for so long as a comedian, and I wasn't respecting it.
Okay.
You know, and I wasn't respecting what was going on with my life. Like, yeah, oh yeah, I'm just on the road. I'm here. I'm working here. I'm working there. I'm this, that, and I didn't care. And it wasn't like I always wrote. It wasn't like I wasn't writing, but I was just sticking to kind of like the same act and not caring and going on autopilot, and maybe the bits weren't as strong as, you know, that I felt they were. So when I went on autopilot, it wasn't the same thing. But I tell you, after all those years and going back, and then really, my father died in 2009. So he didn't really get to see, you know, he got to see me do some commercials.
Right, science screen a little bit.
You know, but nothing special. Actually, the true story was, I was in Down to Earth with Chris Rock, and I had a line or something that got cut, but I'm the Gray's Papaya guy with him and Regina Hall, the one from, is she in Friday? I mean, I think it's Friday.
Oh yeah. Oh God,
yeah. Regina King. Yeah. Yes. And so you know, they're all great, and you know, we're talking and hanging out, and my dad goes to see Down to Earth with my mom. They're the only ones in the theater. Chaz Palminteri's in it. Everybody's in it, you know. And my dad goes, literally, he goes to my mom, yeah, I'll be right back. And he goes to the projector room, and he knocks on the thing, and the guy's like, yeah. Hello? He's like, yeah, look, my son's in this movie. Could you fast forward it to his part so we can get the fuck out of here?
Shit.
True story. My mom's like, Mike, what is wrong with you?
Just cut through the chase.
I'm going to sit through this piece of shit.
Cut through the chase.
Wow.
Well, you know, it's funny what you said there. You know, the audience, you went on autopilot, but you didn't know that, but the audience knew you enough. Or
yeah.
They could tell enough to go that this guy's just phoning it in.
So when I started doing the cruises, which I now do 4 to 5 different, completely different 30-minute shows on the cruise. I do adult-rated, R-rated, dirty, and then I do 2 clean shows.
Uh-huh.
And my wife sees me headline the Pechanga Casino the other day, and she hadn't seen me in a while. And she was like, you're like a different comic. She's like, you are so strong now, honey. She's like, there's just, she goes, the cruises took you to a new level. Now, some people would not cruises. Oh, that's where comedians go to die, but not anymore.
Right.
I'm on the cruises. Dean Edwards is on the cruises. I mean, there's just so many. Mark Theobald, who tours with Tracy Morgan, he was on the cruises. There's just so many different people.
Well, Lewis Black was doing a cruise.
Yeah.
Bobby Collins does them.
Chris Tucker just did them.
Yeah.
Jim Gaffigan. Everybody's doing a cruise. Nick Swartzen. Everyone's doing them now. It's not, that's not the thing no more, that it's like, it's not like that's where you,
yeah, that's,
you go.
That stigma's not there anymore. You're right.
Yeah. So it took me to a new level.
Well, plus you had to do the clean and the dirty, and that's definitely going to make you stronger right there.
And the thing was, the greatest thing about doing it was, this guy says to me, who was running, he was one of the comedy managers, But he actually was a comedian for like 30 years, and he's really, really amazing. And his name is Jeff the Fun Dude, just a great guy. And Jeff Shaw is his real name, and he's been around for years. And he said to me, he said, yeah, he goes, you're really funny. He goes, I think that you could fine-tune this and to be so strong on that stage. So I saw him in January, and then I was back on the cruise in March. And he comes up to me, and I'm just killing every show. And he was like, really good sets, really good. He goes, you took my advice. And I go, yeah. And I go, I kind of did. I don't really understand what the advice was because there was so much advice and you're just so knowledgeable. I couldn't understand. And I tried, and he said, and then what he said was, he goes, what you're doing on the stage is you're selling this character that's so unbelievable that it's that there's no way that this guy would say, you know, say this. Like, it's not. So I did a show, and he explained to me. I said, well, I don't understand. I go, I'm just doing my thing. He goes, no. He goes, you're getting away with whatever you want to say because of your character so strong. And I didn't really know I was a character, you know.
Right.
But then he was right. What it was I said something about who went to Catholic school. And someone said, you know, they went to Catholic school. And I said, oh, I went to, that's what they said. They go, Saint, and this was in the clean show. And she goes, I went to Saint Mary's.
Uh-huh.
And I go, Saint Mary, I dated her. It crushed. I mean, it crushed like you couldn't imagine. And then I tagged it with another thing that killed as well and that I made up.
Right.
And he goes to me after. He goes, I saw you go to the, like, you didn't go too far because it's a clean show. He goes, but in the adult show, you could have took it to a level that what people would have went insane, like dying. He goes, but what you did was that character, you know what I mean? Because, so like, you know, anybody would go, yeah, I went to Cas, oh, St. Mary's, yeah, I dated her. That's funny. But I go, I dated her.
Yeah.
And they went nuts. So then I realized what it became was this whole different thing of talking and just, you know, like I do a bit, I say my wife, I say, yeah, my wife, me and my wife have been together for almost 15 years. We're married 13. My mom and dad, 54 years, and my sister, 40-something years. And I told my wife, I said, we're going to be together forever because we are a team. And my wife goes, ugh, I want to be traded. Right? So I now know how to take every bit, every premise, and take it to that next level. And that's really what the ships really taught me. Because I had never had that, you know, like, I could just go headline a club and do whatever I wanted. 45 minutes, 50 minutes, an hour, and I'm done.
Right.
This is now, do your 30 minutes, get off the stage, do another 30, different 30, another, you know what I mean?
Well, it sounds like you learned how to personalize each show now, basically.
Yeah, it took me to a new level, and I really am happy.
It doesn't affect your bits. You can personalize it, and it's actually more fun for you too at that point.
Yeah, and I work for Carnival Cruise Lines, and I'm honored. I really am honored. You know, so that's it. I love it.
Do you have a favorite? You know, like a favorite style to work, if you were to work clean or dirty? I mean, what's more comfortable for you? Or because you've done it so long, is it kind of, you just kind of just depends on where you're at, man. Just roll with it.
When I started, I was always dirty. And my wife, who's been with me 15 years, she was like, you really should work clean. If you could work clean, you would work more of, you know, in corporate. You know, these corporates that'll pay, you know,
sure,
just killer right money. And I said, yeah, I don't know. I don't feel that it's, you know, good. I don't know. So I started, like, learning. Once again, 2 years of doing the ships, I started learning how to write clean, like, you know, and I took, like, my ailment. I said, yeah, I'm a big guy. I say big guys have a thing called IBS, irritable bowel syndrome.
Uh-huh.
It's hereditary. It runs in your genes. Boom. hilarious joke. And I go, I know, it's a crappy joke. Let it go.
Let it go.
Seriously, let it go. Right? So it's like you can do it in the, you can do that in a corporate show. So I just started realizing, okay, my wife, you know, boom, boom, boom. Let me write all these jokes. I never knew how to write clean jokes. And now I feel like I said, I feel like I went to a new level. So when I do my new comedy special, man, I literally have 3 hours of material, 2.5 to 3 hours of material that I do every ship. Plus crowd work that ends up really well, you know, and having so much fun.
So you can you basically start out your bits clean and then pepper them as you need to. If you need to cuss, you don't start with the cussing. You don't have to.
You know, I headlined a show called The Dirty at 12:30 in Vegas. I've done it a million times. They love me. I'm one of the favorites there. And I do the show, and you know, I brought a guy to open for me, and, you know, he's supposed to do, like, 12 minutes or something. And within, like, 4 minutes, the dude's like, yeah, he's like, dude, I got to get this guy off. He's too clean. He doesn't get it. And I go, yeah, you know, he normally does fine, but that's fine. Cut him. I don't give a shit. Right?
Uh-huh.
And he had flown in from New York to do the show. And, you know, and he used to open for me. He no longer works for me. But the point of the story is, I went up, and then my best friend, comedian Tim Homeyoun, was with me, too. So he was going on right before me, and he said to me, he goes, yeah, see, he goes, he was too clean. He goes, he doesn't get it. He goes, you don't have to be dirty on The Dirty at 12:30. You just got to be funny, confident, and if it's clean, it's fine.
Right.
So, like, I just started, you know, realizing that it was like, if you're clean, so it's just what I realized was it's just the attitude.
Sure. And if you're basically doing clean, you know, correct me if I'm wrong, you can kind of get away with a little more when you poke into the dirty a little bit. You know what I mean?
Completely.
You're just stretching yourself out a little more and giving them more than they bargained for. You're like, oh, shit, he just said that, you know, after hearing you for 15, 20.
No, exactly. Exactly. You know, and that's what it became was the, you know, like it became this, you know, the attitude. And the attitude was like, and you think I'm saying the F word.
Right. You're expecting it. Yeah, you're subliminally hearing
like,
it.
Like, did he just say fuck? Did he say motherfucker? Did he say fuck? And I might not say, you know what I mean? And I'm like, no, it's a kid's show. And I'll record all the kid's shows. They're called PG shows, but there are kids that are. So if you look on my website, if people go to funnyjimmy.com, you go to the second video in the comedian section, and that's me performing on the Punchliner Comedy Club on Carnival, and there was a kid in the audience. He's walking back and forth, you know, whatever, he's taking a shit, I don't know what he's doing. But, like, he keeps going back. But he did take a picture with me after, and a lot of times the people, the kids with their parents will come up, you're my favorite comedian. I watch Comedy Central all the time, you know, so.
You know, I think it's funny about that, too, is a lot of times if you watch any kind of animated stuff, there's hidden humor in there for adults that kids have no idea what's going on.
Yeah, well, I mean, like I said, I'm 45. I mean, I came up on Bugs Bunny and all that stuff, right? And these commercial or these cartoons now are not, you know what I mean? Those, you know, the Flintstones, all that stuff was written for adults.
Right, you know? And it's like, no, it's a, no, really watch and listen.
Yeah.
Right? And the kids are just like, ah, it's cartoon, no big deal. And parents are like, oh, yeah, I get it. I got it.
Exactly.
Now,
exactly.
When you started working clean, this happened to me. I did a Comedy Time thing about 5 years ago. And they said, you know, no cussing, nothing dirty, you know, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And it's at that point you don't really realize what you do, you know, as far as your cussing and stuff, because you assume you're just doing your bits, and it kind of, you overthink it a little bit. You're like, oh God, I can't say this, I can't say that, but you really don't do that too much anyways.
Right.
You know, it's kind of, did it mess with your head a little bit? Were you worried about what you were saying?
Oh yeah, I was really scared when I got hired to work Carnival. My agent was like, you have to go there with 90 minutes minimum, and you have to do one clean show, then you can repeat the clean show because people will come back or whatever the deal is.
Right.
And then you do a 30-minute adult, and then you do, you can repeat that one again, and then you do a different 30. And those are your five shows.
Right.
But that, now I go from between four and five shows, and that's it. Because I don't, it literally breaks my heart to you know that my bits will, you know, kill, and then see that, you know, someone go, he did that yesterday. Right. And you're like, ugh. Like,
yeah.
Like, the audience is still laughing, but a couple people might be there. So that was it. So I said to my agent, I said, well, I'm going to work really hard to get to the four or five sets so no one can ever do that. And once I started doing that, that really took it to a new level.
Well, sure, your confidence plus your material, yeah. Like you said, you got 4 hours right there. And, you know, it's a catch-22 for us comics because you get bored doing your stuff. You don't want someone to come back to a show and you go, I don't want to bore you. You know, at the time, you're thinking of something new, but also there's your strong set that 90% of the rest of the audience needs to hear, you know?
Well, you know, it's funny because I did Comedy Time probably 6 or 8 times.
I saw your Shark Week bit on that one. That cracked me up. He said, what do you do when you come across a shark? What the guys say, run?
Oh, yeah, they say run. I go, what are you, Jesus?
Jesus, yeah.
They always say, like, actually that bit transformed into my new bit about bears, where I do the shark bit sometimes, not all the time, but my new bit is like, what if you're attacked by a bear in the forest? And I say, well, you know, you're supposed to lay down and play dead so the bear can eat you slowly. And I go, not only works for the brown bear, you do that with the black bear, it's a different situation. Black bear attacks, you lay down, you play dead, he might steal your sneakers. Especially if they're Bear Jordans. If they're Bear Jordans.
Right. You just got the crowd with you on that.
You know, so, and it's like, you know, so it's just, but it's like you can't go, he steals your sneakers. Like, you know, you have to, you know, and I've already talked about my brother-in-law's black, 40 years in my family, one of my best friends, I love him to death. So yeah. I talk all about all, you know, I've dealt with all black people and their culture my whole life.
Well, like you said, you can't throw a hack punch out like that, you know what I mean? Yeah, you're working the persona on it. It's perfect.
Exactly, yeah. So it but, you know, it literally took a little bit of time to get that joke to work the way that I wanted.
Sure.
And then, you know.
Do you still have that one joke from years ago you're still tweaking? Or the premise of it, you know. I've got one that I had, I think, since I started. It's been probably 7-8 years. And it has morphed into this whole different thing, but I'm still hanging on to it because I love it. But I keep changing it, twisting it, and tagging it, you know, pretty much every time I go on. Yeah, you know, a lot of people have one. I didn't know if you would have one.
Yeah, you know, I do. I'm trying to think right now. Actually, it's funny because the Chippendale. Did you see my Comedy Central thing that I did?
I didn't see it, no.
Okay, so that was called Last Comic Stealing. And I sue my best friend. And Doug Benson is the judge. It's called the High Court. So anyway, so I went on there and I sued my best friend for a joke that he stole that my father gave him. And it's, you know, saying I used to be a Chippendale dancer, now I'm a Chips Ahoy dancer. So anyways, always get to laugh. They always like the joke. And the nice thing about it is when Doug goes to deliberate, he goes in the back room and he gets high. And he's talking to the bailiff. And Jessamay Peluso, who played the guest host or whatever, guest bailiff, and he says, he goes, I bet you that guy Jimmy sells that joke every night. He goes, maybe I don't think it's funny. He goes, but I bet you every night he makes that joke work. And what happened was, I'm doing the joke, and over the years, of course, you know, it's a one-liner, but now it's like, you know, now there's more to the bit. It's like Chips Ahoy Dancer. And I go, I told that joke the other day. I said to this guy, I say, hey, big guy, you know, I said, I would dance my ass off for a cookie. Do you have a cookie? I know you stole one from the buffet. And I go, can you believe that this guy threw a fucking cookie up? out of his hand, his pocket, and he threw up a cookie. And I'm like, what the hell is wrong with you? I picked it up, and I go to throw it back, and I ate it. So it's now became this whole, like, little stupid story.
Yeah, the one thing, like I said, it kind of like dares myself to keep that joke, my bit, my premise, since it's changed so much, and I always love it, and I just love twisting it and tagging it as I go.
What's your bit? Tell me the bit. We'll make it better.
There you go.
Yeah, it started out as it's my open mic stuff, a tag about how every drug causes anal leakage. And then it twisted into old commercials where they used to sing to you and make you feel better, but now everything's a drug. And now it twisted into some Viagra experience. So I'm 52 now, so you know, I'm talking about looking forward to doing the Viagra, but worried about the anal leakage still.
Right.
You know,
right.
But I will have the depends on, you know what I mean? I can go all these different ways with it down based on my age.
Right. Right.
Yeah, so I'm just twisting it from that to this, and just, you know, I just throw out an idea when I'm on stage and go for the reaction and go, okay, I got it. That's the way I'm going to go with it. You know, I'll keep that premise, which isn't the same premise anymore, but that part of that joke, I'll keep it probably till the end.
Right. Well, no, and that's a, you know, it's a great premise. I mean, I've heard, you know, comics do anal leakage jokes about eating chips or whatever. You know, there's always anal leakage. But your thing is, you know, in my mind, I would say, but now I'm 52, so now I take Viagra, and the anal leakage is, that's my wife's problem.
It's not my concern anymore.
You just go, that's my wife's problem. She said she wanted lubrication. She's got it.
That's a different wet spot in the sheet, just saying.
You know what I mean? That's where I'd go with that joke.
Yeah, like I said, I just work my age with it now, and just don't be afraid of it. Just go for it.
Yeah, you know, that was the thing. It's funny. Steve Schaefer, who's one of my favorite comedians, I don't know if you go look him up. He just did a play. He just wrote a play called A Comedy. Anyways, it's here in L.A. And Mark Schiff, who tours with Jerry Seinfeld, who's another one of my favorite comedians.
Oh, I saw him at the Long Beach Laugh Factory probably 3 years ago, and he's been one of my favorites forever.
Yeah, so you should go see his play. I think it's already sold out, but I went to the opening night, you know, and they invited me and Steve Schaefer. Anyways, you know, Jerry Seinfeld was roommates, at least that's what I was told by Steve years ago. He was roommates, you know, with Steve back in the day, and he's sitting there and he's looking at his calendar, and Steve goes, what the fuck, you got more dates than me? How the fuck you got? He goes, Jerry's not famous, he's just a comedian just running around town doing spots,
right?
And he's going, he goes, what are you talking about? He goes, your calendar, look, it's got X's everywhere. Everywhere on the thing, it's got X's. He goes, stupid. He goes, that is where me and Larry Miller wrote for over 6 hours a day. Seriously. And he said the whole calendar was fucking X'd out.
Wow.
Damn.
And I was like, wow, what a work ethic this guy had, you know? And I barely know Jerry. Met him, like, once or twice. I did Gotham, and he was on the show. You know, it wasn't like, I mean, of course I went on before him, you know, but it wasn't really like I opened for him.
Right.
But, you know, and I briefly talked to him and talked to him about a bit and stuff. And he's like, he goes, listen, he goes, you can make any bit funny. You just have to think about it. And he's like, what you need to do is take every joke and write, you know, between 5 and 10 punchlines for every joke, and then figure them out. And I was like, oh, wow, okay.
Yeah, I do the same thing now. I'll come up with a funny premise, but it's the writing and interpreting it, translating it out of my brain, and it's like, okay, here we go. You got it's work time, it's study time, and you just rewrite it. I do that on a Facebook post when I'm trying to be funny.
I had a comedian I had to delete and block.
Actually, she was a break dancer, actually. I think I might have brought her back into Facebook. I can't remember. But I've known her forever. And she's actually a famous break dancer. She was in Beat Street or consultant or whatever. But anyway, she's a comedian now. And I posted. I did a post, and I had about 200 comments. I had likes. I had everything. And everybody was rewriting the joke. I was like, hey, have fun. Rewrite this joke. Bah, 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 bah. And she had written about 20 comments, and they were all really funny. I'm like, so now this is my new thing where I go, if somebody writes, I go, yeah, I'm putting that in the act. And people go, no, you know, that's my joke, or you know, whatever the hell they do, they right. say. And she was like, are you kidding me? She made the biggest deal. Are you kidding me? You're going to take that? That's called troll punching or some troll punchline.
make our own shit up.
Yeah, like made up this bullshit lot. Like, and I was like, what? She's like, I'm not. She goes, most people aren't going to tell you that, Jimmy, but you cannot use the jokes that we're right. I go, then don't fucking write the jokes. I go, I put it out here as an experiment. It doesn't mean I'm going to even use the joke, but I just put it out here. I wrote a premise, and everyone wrote a bit about it, and it was hilarious.
Yeah. I did that. I had a comic friend. She did the same. Well, she did a post on something, and I tagged it. And she goes, she private messaged me. She goes, you know, I do a bit about this. This is my bit. She goes, can I use your tag? I said, it's yours. You asked for it.
Right.
Yeah. No worries. Take it. It's not going to help my bit at all.
Yeah. That's you remember when Seinfeld and Chris Rock are literally like my two favorites.
Yeah.
And me and Tony Rock were actually in acting class together.
Oh shit.
In New York. So, you know, we're still good friends. I mean, if I see him, you know, I barely see him. But it's, you know, but if he sees me, he's like, hey! but the guy actually who tours with him is Garrett Dixon, who I do all those barbershop videos. Have you seen those?
Is that the Living Color?
Yeah, no, Garrett Dixon. We do these barbershop videos, which are, you know, like really quick viral videos, really funny. Like the other day, I'm the first guy to get my hair cut by a black barber. So we did that, and actually the cops, because he comes out and I'm talking. I'm going, yo, it's amazing. You got to see it. You know, I'm like a little homeboy. Yeah, it's great. Oh man, mama. And then all of a sudden he comes in the car. Give me the money. I'm like, what? I'm like, Garrick? He's like, give me the money, man. And he robs me. Anyways, we were gorilla shooting it, and the fucking cops came, and next thing you know, we had 14 guns on us. It was crazy.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, it was all over Facebook. It was Facebook Live. It was crazy.
Oh, damn.
So that was pretty scary. But anyways, Garrick, he does these barbershop videos, which are just so funny, man. They all go viral.
I gotta check them out.
Yeah, I'm looking right now, actually. I'm putting them on the playlist for later. Gotta sit down and watch them all.
Yeah, his barbershop. Yeah, and if you look at, like, best of the 2016, one or two of mine are in there and stuff. I've done two or three, I can't remember.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, but anyways. Yeah, but that's it, man. I was seeing that you're posting, you're doing shows. You're doing a show or something?
Thursday.
Yeah, Thursday we're doing an
Alzheimer's deal.
Oh, you guys are doing let me know about doing a show. If I'm ever in town, I'd love to come out and do a spot or something.
Oh, that's awesome. We have a monthly room we do out in Chino, and we bring up, you know, like Jody Miller's been out, Helen Hong. Would definitely love to have you out on that. So we'll definitely get together for something like that. That's perfect. What do you got coming up next, Jimmy? I saw here on Amazon you actually have a DVD out there.
Oh yeah, my comedy special is on Amazon right now, and I'm gonna put another one out. That one was shot a couple of years ago, and what happened was I wasn't even gonna release it, and then I just decided, you know, okay, let's, and then Amazon picked it up, so you know, people can go to Jimmy Della Valle, funnyjimmy.com. You can actually click and go there, and you can find the special on there. We can click and go watch it. Or I'm also the sidekick on a new talk show called Flores and Friends for Robert Rodriguez of the El Rey Network, and we just shot the pilot, and we got picked up by Amazon. So that will start airing late summer, Flores and Friends. I'm the sidekick like Andy Richter.
Oh, nice.
And I do sketches. I do Man on the Street. It's really fun.
Well, you're definitely going to post that up. So we'll catch that, and we'll put that on our page too, and share that with everybody.
Yeah. So a lot of good things coming up. But yeah, next week I am on the Carnival Fantasy. Next week I'm for Carnival Cruise Lines. I'm on the Carnival Fantasy out of
Mobile, Alabama.
Mobile, Alabama.
Yeah, I'm looking at it right now. Damn. Gotta go out and take a cruise.
No shit, right?
Oh, yeah, they're a lot of fun. I just had a girl, a beautiful girl from New Orleans, she messaged me. She's like, hey, are you going to be on the Dream in April? Because, you know, I'm going, and her and all her girlfriends and stuff. And I'm like, no. And she's like, she's all upset.
Get like, a refund.
I'm like, no, the comics will be great. You know, just tell them, you know, that they... that I'm your favorite comic.
Perfect.
When you meet him.
Well, I want to thank you big time for coming on, Jimmy. It's been a blast meeting you and talking with you. And a big shout out to Steve Cooper for hooking us up together, man.
Oh, yeah. Great. Thanks a lot, man. And you guys are plugging. Is it going to be plugged and everything? All my funnyjimmy.com.
Absolutely. What we're going to do is we're live now, but I'll put this up as a podcast tomorrow, and I'll put all the tags up there, put your webpage on there and all that, and definitely hook you up with all the tags, and so people will definitely see it. We have one thing we do here on the show you're going to have to do with us.
Okay.
All our guests have to do. We call it the Great Eight Quiz. It's 8 questions. There's no right or wrong answer. It's just random questions.
Okay.
And it's your turn, Jimmy. So here we go. Question number 1. Letterman or Leno?
Letterman.
Absolutely. Okay. Number 2, what's your chill music? What do you go to?
Pretty much, it's kind of crazy. It's actually, when I play poker, I like to listen to Sia.
Oh. Wow. Well, look at that. Nice. Nice. Number 3, a comic inspiration, mentory. What got you really juiced up?
I didn't say this earlier, but I quit stand-up for a couple of years. I was into gambling and getting into a lot of craziness, like big time. And I met Dave Chappelle, and we were at Caroline's, and we were hanging out, and he was like, what the fuck? He's like, you quit. Need to get back on stage, man, blah, 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 and gave me information to his manager, and that was in 96, and I'd been back in it since.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Number 4, what is your go-to comedy movie?
Midnight Run.
Oh, yeah, Robert De Niro.
There you go.
It's my all-time favorite movie, but Coming to America, probably.
Ah, yes.
Yeah, hands down.
Yeah. That's that damn movie that comes on. I don't care where it's at. You can't just not watch it.
You can't not. I mean, even I'm jerking off. Boom.
Stop and watch it.
Even I'll cut the hell on ABC Family. You still have to watch it.
Yeah. It doesn't matter.
Number 5. This ought to be good. What was the last thing that pissed you off? Major, minor? What was it?
A bad beat in poker, man. I had the motherfucking nuts on the flop. I bet big. The dude raised way over. He raised 4 times my bet. I bet 500. He bet 2,000 in chips. the turn, I've got queen 10, and there was king 9 jack, and I had the straight flush draw as well, but I had the straight to the king. And the turn is a blank. There's nothing special. I bet 500. He bets 2,000 in chips. I said, what the fuck? And I thought about pushing all in. I was like, please don't pair the board. Please don't pair the board. Bam. Board pairs. Jack, fucking whatever. I don't remember. Anyways, he ended up with jacks full of kings. I wanted to flip the table.
You know who did that to me in Aruba? It was Eric Seidel.
Oh, yeah. Well, Eric.
I had him freaking nail. I flopped a straight. He just came to the table, and I had a good, like, into the second hour. And he just sat down, and I bet, and I'm like, man, he doesn't have me beat. And I pushed, and he, like, bullied over the top of me, and I just pushed in on him and said, hell with it, I'm going, right?
Mm-hmm.
He flopped runner, full house, knocked me out. I was like, are you freaking kidding me? Really? Right now? This has just happened to me.
Yeah, this just happened.
And I talked to him in the bar afterwards, and I'm like, Eric, I got to know. I mean, come on, you're a pro. You got a bracelet. You got everything. Was that an was that an awful play on me? He goes, no, man, it's probably the worst call I made all tournament. But sorry it happened to you. Have a nice day.
Exactly. That was a really nice guy.
He's a great guy.
I've flown with him before. But, yeah, it was, it has not, it happened to me Thursday. But anyways, I cannot get the fucking thing out of my head.
That'll hang. That'll be there. All right, number six, your pizza leftovers, cold or warmed up?
I will eat cold pizza, like cold pussy, but I will, I would like it warmed up, a little warmed up.
Very nice. Seven, what's your favorite cuss word?
Fucking cunt. I mean, it's a non-issue. The non-issue cunt is the greatest word on the face of the earth. True story. My father used to get mad at me. That was my dad's favorite word. It's my favorite word. And if my cat could say it, he would say it because he hears me all the time. I'm telling you, I hear him meow, too. He'll be like, and I'm like, he's saying cunt. He is saying
That's what I heard. That's what I heard.
It's insane. That really is the truth. My father got mad. He goes, what did I tell you about swearing in front of your mother? I go, what? He goes, you don't swear in front of your mother. She's not one of your cunt girlfriends. You understand? As my mom is sitting there, we're at the table, and I'm probably 15.
Yeah, that kind of sounds a little like my dad. That, yeah, I flashback right there. All right, the number eight, the last one. This is our favorite one, and everyone has one. What is your best impression?
You know, my wife hates it more than anything, but it's the first show I ever did, the first paid show I ever did. It really was almost like the first stand-up show that I did. I got to open up for Gilbert Godfrey.
Oh, my God.
And it was 500 people in the audience. And I do Gilbert Godfrey, and I do him great.
Let's hear it.
Want to hear it? My wife's going to get mad. She hates it. Nobody likes it. I go, get the applause. That's his hack. She knows the word. So I'll do it because I don't give a shit because it's just something that's sentimental to me, right?
There you go.
So anyways, Gilbert Godfrey at the buffet. Oh, yes, I'm Gilbert Godfrey. Where is the toilet paper? Screw it, I'll wipe my ass with a duck. Affleck.
That was loud enough. I know she heard that.
Yeah. She definitely heard. She's in the other room.
Oh, shit. Jimmy, again, thanks, buddy. We had a blast with you, my friend.
Thank you so much.
Awesome,
I'm definitely going to send you guys an email so you can make sure to get me the Jimmy Della Valle VIP page because that's where I want the people in my group to add me. The personal thing is, you know, they can get in there, but then I throw them out and I throw them into the VIP anyways. But it's usually full, 5,000, the other thing.
Right on.
Okay.
Well, send
it
through.
Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks again, Jimmy. We'll talk with you soon, buddy.
Okay. Bye-bye.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Oh,
man. He was a blast.
Kidding me?
I gotta catch. I gotta take a knee after this one. We're gonna take a quick break.
A quick break and come back and regroup. And what the hell just happened?
Big shout out. That was awesome.
You're listening to Roy and Jimmy Thing here on chaoticradio.com. We're taking a knee. We'll see you in a minute. Welcome back to the Roy and Jimmy Thing, chaoticradio.com. Give us a call if you want to. Last break is over. We only got a couple minutes, so you don't have a lot of time, but do it quick if you're going to.
Yeah, wind on our last 20 minutes here. Big shout out to Jimmy Della Valle for calling in, Frankie Ray for calling in. What a total blast. Definitely look him up. Catch him when you can. That was hilarious. Big shout out to our buddy Steve Cooper for hooking us up with Jimmy there.
Thanks, Coop. I'm your Newman. I don't know why he calls me that.
Hello, Newman. That was awesome. So definitely check out the podcast when we put this up.
Oh, man. 20 minutes. We got 11 minutes. Holy shit.
Yeah. Is that close?
Wow.
That close, man. So how do we wrap that up?
I don't know.
How do we follow Jimmy?
Let's see. See if I have anything stupid. Come on. Sopranos, Conan, Comedy Central, Without a Trace, My Name is Earl, and Fabulous Oz, Sex and the City, America's Got Talent. Are you kidding me? And he played the World Poker Tour. You know, chatted with him a little about poker.
Oh, absolutely. And his website, funnyjimmy.com. Check out. He's got his dates up there. He's got videos. YouTube him. Just a ton of funny stuff up there.
Hey, we got to find out. We got a honeymoon coming up. We got to make sure he's on the boat.
There you go.
I got to make a special request. I want Jimmy on a boat. Think they'll do that?
We got actually a caller squeezing in right here.
Oh, last man. Year. Last time.
All right. You got Roy and Jimmy.
Really? I thought I was on a boat.
Hey, Dennis. How you doing, buddy?
Hi, Dennis.
I'm out of breath. I'm out of breath listening to Jimmy.
Yeah?
Want to eat something?
Yeah. You know, I met him or we used to be Facebook friends. We're not anymore. I don't know what happened or maybe he probably unfriended me, you know, but because we both liked Midnight Run. So,
yeah, we saw that. You know, that was definitely yeah. You know you and Jimmy DeValle.
Yeah, you guys all connected right. On that one.
Yeah. So what's going on? Anything else good?
No, we're just trying to figure out how to wrap that shit up.
fuck, I don't know.
I don't know. You know, I got one.
Huh?
Did you see the new craze in women's underwear?
No.
New craze. New one.
Okay.
Fake camel toe underwear.
Oh, I saw that.
Yeah, I seen that too. I said something about it. That's probably where the women put their balls.
It's a built-in camel toe underwear.
These days, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're all three of us are old enough to go, what the fuck is that?
Yeah.
Wasn't that something they always tried to stay away from?
Right.
It's like, I don't want to have that, and now all of a sudden you want to get underwear to make you say you have it?
It's sort of like a Kardashian thing, you know, if you got the big ass and the big old camel toe or
I guess
fucking the elephant toe or whatever it is.
You know what I think? Oh, right there, there's our niche. We make men moose knuckle underwear.
Well, you know, I think if it's expected, I guess they're just going to provide it. You know what I mean? If you look at her ass going, well, you know, I think they're going to think I have a camel toe, so let's give them one.
Yeah.
Gee, isn't that the equivalent of putting, tissue in your bra? You know, once you get down to the the dirty there, all of a sudden you're pulling out parts and pieces, you know?
Well, you know, sir, I'm a kid from the 60s and 70s where the girls just wore tight Levi's and,
tight dittos.
Dittos.
Yeah, them too. You could feel the fit in those. But I mean, you haven't seen no camel toe or nothing like that. It was just, you've either seen a mound or a whatever, but camel toes, I think it came in with the spandex and shit like that.
Okay. Yes.
Well, everyone's wearing yoga, all the women are wearing yoga pants, so we're seeing everything, so why add to it?
Well, there's some that shouldn't wear.
Oh, yeah, we definitely know that. We definitely
should be wearing a muumuu or something.
Walmart should not be selling yoga pants. That's all we need to say.
No.
And it's a great invention. It's just for the right people. I mean, I see guys that probably look good in a half shirt or something. I ain't wearing one. What's that thing? Just because they make it in your size doesn't mean you should wear it, right?
Exactly.
Exactly, yes.
I can't. Oh, wow. I just pictured myself in some stuff that probably I could go to the fat guy store and buy and go, no, probably not.
Yeah, but I'll bet you dollar to donuts, you guys just wear the cut-off Levi's with your boxers hanging off the bottoms of them.
No, I didn't.
I did not, and I didn't wear boxers.
I didn't wear boxers either.
I
wore boxer briefs way back then when they weren't cool.
They're called orthopedic underwear. That's when he started wearing them.
Yeah, there was like, they'd be like maybe a little thing. What is that you're wearing? Well, you know why? It's because baseball players wore it like that.
Gotcha. Yep.
And so I mean, like we're talking when I was in junior high school, I used to wear those because they're comfortable, give you a little support, but they're not binding though, and that's what I wore then. And everyone thought they were hard to find. Now it's a cool thing because I was a trendsetter.
Right.
You set the bar. Yeah, and boxers, to me, it was just too much free balling to even serve a purpose at that point. But when boxer briefs came out, fucking heaven sent.
Yes.
That's the shit right there.
I used to run around with my cut-off Levi's, and my boxers are hanging down, and a barefoot in a Levi jacket.
That's the era right there. You set the tone right there. Yeah. you have set the fucking scene.
Shorts, barefoot, and a jacket. And I'm like...
true. Southern Cal right there.
Yeah.
And your Mopar.
What kind of fucking retard is this guy? Oh.
No, you were everyone else, too. Yeah. The fact I didn't do it, I was the retard out of place.
Right.
Yeah.
Somebody said one time, why are you boxers hanging out? That's because if I didn't, there's something else to be hanging out down there.
No.
Oh, okay.
Oh, there it is. There it is. Yeah. Hey, how you feeling, man? You over it? You got remnants?
No.
What?
I have bumps and knots all over my lower back still. Oh,
man, I am not looking forward to this shit. I'm not looking forward
hopefully,
to it.
Hopefully you don't get it. I hope nobody I know gets it. Yeah. So, I mean, I would take, a Norco or whatever, and it doesn't really seem to ease the pain. And now most of the pain itself is over, but sometimes I'll just get like, feels like somebody punched me in the back or something.
Right.
But the knots and the bumps, my doctor said that the knot that's underneath one of those things will go away, but man, it's been 3 weeks. Go away already.
Please, stop.
Just leave. Doctor said it was leaving. Get the hell out.
Yeah. You're on restriction, man. Get back in fitness. Yeah, so I don't know. I think I told you guys I take the pills, and the ointment that they have for the cream is $800.
What?
Well, yeah, $800, but I can get the generic for $150.
Oh.
What the fuck, man? That's a tube of cream.
Jesus.
No, it's not. It's ointment.
Ointment. Where I just took a tube of toothpaste and I rubbed it on there, and I figured I can polish it up later.
Don got a new tube of this stuff, toothpaste. Have you seen this stuff? It's black.
No.
It's black toothpaste,
that.
And it's supposed to like really whiten your teeth. Like there's, it's charcoal or something in it.
Right.
I haven't tried it yet. It's at home. I keep going, bust that shit out. I want to try it.
Well, she's in the dental arena, so there might be a little validation for that.
I don't know. Here's the thing. She hadn't used it yet.
Ah.
But she ordered it. Didn't know why it took so long to get here. So, man, she ordered it like months ago.
Really?
Well, it came from Japan.
Oh, and make up some white teeth.
And make a whiter teeth over Japan because they make a lot of smoky when they come to Japan.
Yes, they do. No.
Well, we are wrapping it up, Dennis. That 2 hours have flown by.
Flown
by. So you have a good week. We're definitely going to check in with you next Monday, Mr.
All right, guys. And peace out. Love you guys. Have fun.
Love you too, buddy. Thanks for calling in, buddy.
All right, bye.
Oh, man, what a great show. So big shout out again to Jimmy Della Valle. Check his website out, funnyjimmy.com. Is the movie coming out? Look for that coming up. He's going to hit the festivals with it. It's called The Cross Up. Another one, Marriage Vows, coming up behind that. He's on tour. He's hitting the cruise ships. Just check him out on his page, funnyjimmy.com. Go to Amazon. He's got a DVD out. It's called It's Just Jimmyism. And all-around funny guy. So definitely check him out.
And thanks, Coop.
Thanks, Coop, for the hookup on that. And that's it, man. We are done.
Thursday night. Next Thursday night. Coming up Thursday night.
Two nights,
3 nights. One, two, third night.
Third night from night.
So you're going to go 1, 2, 3 sleeps.
3 sleeps from now.
Yes.
We have our Alzheimer benefit show we're doing.
Yes.
So I'll host that along with Gus Arredondo, Derek Murray, and our headliner, the hilarious friend of the show, Mr. Sean Williams.
Friend of the show and friend of real life.
In real lives.
See?
Yeah, for reals.
For reals.
For reals, a friend. I can call him anytime. I can call him anytime. He won't be happy about it, but I can call him anytime.
Yeah. Yeah, he's kind of grumpy sometimes.
That's it. But he's over at Atria over here in Rancho Cucamonga on Baseline. All the details are on our page. We're definitely going to post the flyer up again. That's what we do. And we're definitely promote that. It's for Alzheimer's awareness. Definitely come out and support for that. It's a great time. Hors d'oeuvres, a couple drinks on the ticket price, and just enjoy a night of fun.
For a donation only. Don't be a cheap bastard. Spend some money.
Don't be cheap. Come on out. Come on. Pay what you can.
Yeah, our listeners aren't cheap. We are, but they're not. It's a completely different thing.
So, Roy, another good show. Thanks for hanging in there. I know you're not feeling good, buddy.
Oh, man, we got through it, man. Wouldn't miss it. Jimmy, good as always. Good job with the pool on the breakdancing music.
Yeah, Electric Boogaloo, breaking two.
Wow.
All right, man. We'll see y'all next week. Thanks for listening again. You're listening to chaoticradio.com. This has been the Roy and Jimmy Thing.
And that is Jimmy Shaw. And I am Roy Brewster. We'll see y'all next week. Love y'all. Be safe. Hit 'em, baby. You never even